Hey there, this is your daily election show with me, Vikram Chandra, and today we're going to be speaking to a bunch of really special people. Atishi Marlena joining us from the Aam Aadmi Party, Dr. Harshvardhan from the BJP, and we're also going to get from Ram Madhav some sense of the way he thinks the election is actually going. But before I come to any of that, let's quickly take you through all the big election-related news stories of the day in Election Digest.
A setback for opposition as the Supreme Court on Tuesday rejected a review petition filed by 21 opposition parties seeking increased EVM VVPAT verification. The court said that it is not inclined to interfere in the matter and there will be no further increase in the number of EVMs to be tallied with VVPATs.
This petition review and the earlier one talked of VVPAT. Firstly, friends, let me tell you that we bow down to the court order which has just now dismissed our review prayer.
With a little over than 2 weeks left for the Lok Sabha election results to be declared, hectic parleys have already started between political heavyweights in the south. Telangana Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao called on his Kerala counterpart Pinarayi Vijayan on Monday to discuss the national political scenario. Rao is also likely to meet DMK Chief M.K. Stalin and other leaders in the south. The five southern states send 123 MPs to the Lok Sabha. Replying to an RTI filed by a Jammu-based activist, the Defence Ministry has said they do not have any information about any surgical strikes conducted by the Indian Army before 2016. This directly contradicts claims made by Congress leaders that the UPA government conducted 6 surgical strikes during their term. The RTI sought details about surgical strikes between 2004 and 2014, but the DGMO said they only have data about one strike conducted by the Army along the line of control on the 29th of September post the Uri attack. Replying to an RTI filed by a Jammu-based activist, the Defence Ministry has said they do not have any information about any surgical strikes conducted by the Indian Army before 2016. This directly contradicts claims made by Congress leaders that the UPA government conducted 6 surgical strikes during their term. The RTI sought details about surgical strikes between 2004 and 2014, but the DGMO said they only have data about one strike conducted by the Army along the line of control on the 29th of September post the Uri attack.
The Election Commission has given yet another clean chit to Prime Minister Narendra Modi in the complaints alleging violation of Model Code of Conduct. The poll panel has ruled that the roadshow by Prime Minister on the polling day in Gujarat did not violate any rules. The panel has also given Prime Minister a clean chit on the contentious speech in Karnataka. This is the 9th clean chit by the Election Commission to Prime Minister Modi this election season.
BSP Supremo Mayawati, in the clearest signal yet that she wants to be PM, has said that she may have to contest the Lok Sabha elections from Uttar Pradesh's Ambedkar Nagar if all goes well. I may have to seek election from here because the road to national politics passes through Ambedkar Nagar, she said addressing a public rally against a giant cutout of herself in front of the Parliament building captioned Prime Minister. Samajwadi Party Chief Akhilesh Yadav has indicated that he will support BSP Chief Mayawati if she makes a bid for the top job post May 23rd. In an interview to NDTV, Akhilesh, who is in alliance with Mayawati, said that he wants the Prime Minister to be from Uttar Pradesh, adding it shouldn't be from Banaras, referring to PM Modi. Refusing to spell out BSP Supremo's name, Yadav said it will be decided on May 23rd. Chief Electoral Officer of Uttar Pradesh, Lakku Venkateshwarlu, has said allegations of booth capturing in Amethi are false after Union Minister Smriti Irani tweeted a video of a woman who claimed that she was made to vote for the Congress. Venkateshwarlu, while talking to reporters, said the charges levelled by the elderly woman in the video clip that went viral on social media were found to be baseless. India's defence policy is no longer linked to its diplomatic policy, BJP President Amit Shah said in an interview to Hindustan Times, explaining how his party views national security. Diplomatically, India could boldly present its views to other countries and at the same time strike at the source of terror, he said. Shah is convinced that national security, which his party has made the centrepiece of its campaign, will find an echo among voters.
It's BJP Sadhvi versus Digvijay Sadhus in Madhya Pradesh's capital Bhopal. Hundreds of sadhus led by Computer Baba on Tuesday came out in support of the senior Congress leader who is contesting against Sadhvi Pragya of the BJP from Bhopal. The sadhus performed havan to pray for Digvijay's victory.
Bomb blast mein jo phansne wala vyakti जो हत्या में केस में फंसने वाला व्यक्ति जो आतंकवाद के साथ खड़ा रहे और हेमंत करकरे जैसे जिन्होंने अपना जीवन बलिदान कर दिया इस देश के लिए, उनको शराब देना वो साधु नहीं हो सकता है। और सब संत समाज दिग्विजय सिंह को आशीर्वाद देके लाखों बोर से जिताना है।
In a shocking incident, EVMs and VVPAT were found from a hotel in Muzaffarpur in Bihar on Monday. District Magistrate Alok Ranjan Ghosh said that a sector officer was given some reserved machines so that it could be replaced with faulty ones. After replacing EVMs, he was left with two balloting unit, one control unit and two VVPAT in his car. He added that investigation will be carried out as unloading the machines in hotel was against the rules.
Election Commission has allowed relaxation of the Moral Code of Conduct in Maharashtra from May 10th to allow the state government mitigation work in drought-affected areas. After polling for all 48 Lok Sabha seats seized on April 29th in the state, Chief Minister Devendra Fadnavis wrote to the poll body seeking relaxation. EC has directed that no government official involved in election duty should accompany ministers in relief work. Reports say that the state reservoirs have only 19% water left.
All right, let's now listen in to Atishi Marlena, Aam Aadmi Party candidate there in East Delhi. Atishi, thanks for joining us. So how is the election going?
The Delhi elections are going extremely well. There's a lot of positivity on the ground. I think for the first time in Delhi, the people of Delhi have seen a party that has actually done what they promised. And I think it's very rare in politics that people develop trust and faith in political parties. And I think this has happened with the Aam Aadmi Party in the past 4 years, ever since 2015 the government has been formed. And so when we are going to people's homes, they're like, "Haan haan, tumhi ko to vote denge. Hamare ghar mein pani aa gaya, bachchon ke school acche ho gaye. Aur kisko vote denge?"
You know, Atishi, many of the issues that are really affecting the residents of Delhi, education, pollution, some of that, there's a sense that maybe you can't make much headway because the Aam Aadmi Party is at war with the centre. So how are you going to be able to deliver effectively on any of these things? Maybe it's better to therefore vote for the BJP. That's what some voters could say.
See, two things. First of all, yes, there are many things that still remain to be done. One of our major projects, CCTV cameras, has not taken off because for years the files were held up. Mohalla clinics, many of them were delayed. But the thing is that despite so many obstacles, what the Aam Aadmi Party has managed to deliver is much, much more than what the parties before that have delivered. And that is, I think, what is resonating with the people of Delhi, because they can actually feel a substantive change in their lives. Now, as we speak at this moment, most of East Delhi, if you see, lives in unauthorized colonies. And for decades before this, no roads were made in unauthorized colonies, sewer lines were not laid, water pipelines were not laid. And as we speak, at least 10,000 roads across unauthorized colonies in Delhi are being made, with sewer lines, with water pipelines, with nallis on the side. Now, this is something that affects the everyday life of people in a very substantive way. And so this is not something that they can ignore because it affects the quality of their lives.
No, so that's the point that I was making, that is it possible that because these are elections to the parliament and to the Lok Sabha, some voters will feel go with a national party like the BJP and not a party which is a Delhi-centric party like the Aam Aadmi Party. Is that a possibility?
Well, if the BJP had to fix these issues, they had the last 5 years in power. And if they had to do it, they would have done it by now. Second, I think one of the things that is hurting the BJP in East Delhi is that their former MP Mahesh Giri has been an MP in absentia. No one has ever seen him. And now they're feeling that now we have a celebrity who's a candidate. And with the celebrity, Gautam Gambhir is going to be playing cricket, doing commentary in London and Johannesburg and West Indies. How is he going to be available to solve the everyday problems that people face in Trilokpuri and Kondli and Khureji and Mayur Vihar? And what people want from a member of parliament, while you and I may feel that a member of parliament is there to debate larger issues in the House of Parliament, what people want is that if they have a problem at the police station, the MLA should be available to stand by them, the MP should be available to be stand by them. If they need to get someone from their family admitted in Safdarjung or AIIMS, the MP should be there to sign a letter for them. If they have some problems at hospitals, the MP should be able to call a doctor at a hospital, call someone at a school and help them resolve their problems. These are the everyday issues that people are looking from for their representatives. This is exactly the count on which BJP MPs have done very poorly in Delhi. And now people feel that Gautam Gambhir to saal mein se 250 din bahar hi rahega. Wo kya karega hamare liye kaam?
Okay, Atishree, specifically coming to your constituency, is there a certain amount of bad blood that's been building up out there? We saw that entire controversy over your surname. We've also seen a number of attacks on Gautam Gambhir and other things. Is there an election with a lot of bad blood?
Well, see, the thing is, the fact that when people from the Congress and people from the BJP have nothing to say about me or the work that I have done, apart from my surname, apart from false allegations about my religion or my caste, then one can see that they are getting a bit desperate. And I think it's their desperation that is showing, especially for the Congress. I think Congress now realizes that it's in a situation where it might even lose its deposit on all 7 seats. And that is the reason that they're coming up with such allegations.
Just wanted to ask you if that alliance with the Congress party had actually gone through, would the situation in Delhi have been much better? Because then, in seat after seat, it would have been you and the Congress party versus a BJP candidate. Could that have made a big difference?
See, as far as Delhi is concerned, Aam Aadmi Party is capable of defeating the BJP on its own. What we had wanted was a pan-North India alliance that covered Haryana, that covered Punjab, Chandigarh and Delhi, which is 33 seats in all. And if there had been an alliance between Aam Aadmi Party, between the Congress and the JJP in Haryana, BJP could have been routed from all 33 seats. But it's unfortunate that Congress and Rahul Gandhi refused to get into such an alliance. And I think that I'm hopeful that Modi would not be coming back, but if he does, then I think history will not be able to forgive them.
Well, the flip side of that, I guess, would be that the Congress would say that you are not that strong in places like Haryana or Punjab or Goa, so why should they have given you seats there? Yes, the Aam Aadmi Party is a strong force in Delhi, but you're not a force in the others. So 33 minus 7 is a large number of seats where you don't have that much of a presence.
See, they agreed to an alliance between Haryana and Delhi 3 days before, two or 3 days before the nomination. And then on one fine day, they just changed the goalpost and called it off. Their leaders inside closed doors have repeatedly agreed to the fact that if in all 33 seats that we were to contest together, BJP would be totally routed. They would be down to 0 on 33 in these seats. Except it seems that Congress is not very serious about beating the BJP, about defeating the BJP, because you can see that across different states, they're just busy weakening the opposition. They're weakening Aam Aadmi Party in Delhi. They're weakening the SP-BSP alliance in Uttar Pradesh. They're weakening the CPM in Kerala. I mean, what is the reason for Rahul Gandhi to be contesting from Wayanad? Wayanad is a seat that has never been won by the BJP in the history of India. And for him to go and contest there is an indicator that Rahul Gandhi is not fighting BJP. Rahul Gandhi is fighting the third front and he's busy weakening them. If he wanted to fight the BJP, if he wanted to take on Modi, he would have gone and contested from one of the states where Congress and BJP are in a direct fight. He would have contested from Madhya Pradesh, he could have contested from Rajasthan, from Gujarat, but he chose not to.
Okay, Atishree, so just taking off from what you just said, is Narendra Modi coming back then?
My own assessment is that Modi is not coming back. There is going to be a coalition government at the center. I think there are just too many groups across the country that have been alienated by Modi. You have youth who don't have jobs. You have farmers who are in total distress. You have Dalits who have seen atrocities on a scale that they have never seen before. You have minorities who are feeling insecure. And I think that across the board, a very large segment of people have now made up their mind to vote against BJP.
Okay, so that's Atishree Marlena on some of her views. Well, I did get a chance in Twitter dialogue, so sit down with Dr. Harshvardhan, the person, remember, who had been the BJP's candidate for Chief Minister of Delhi in 2013 and has, of course, been Environment Minister, Health Minister also earlier, Science and Technology Minister at the center. So Dr. Harshvardhan, I caught up with him for a Twitter dialogue. I asked him about some of my pet themes, such as air pollution in Delhi, but also on the entire question of statehood for Delhi and why the BJP seems to have done a U-turn on that. This is what he had to say to me. I know people are struggling with many problems and rozi roti ka issues and all of that. So maybe air pollution doesn't become the election issue that it should. But are you being asked this question when you're on the road? Are people saying that this is something which is a major thing? And how can you telling the people in Delhi that you can, or elsewhere in NCR, North India, how do we fix this?
Let me tell you that for us also it's a very, very major issue. And in the last 2-3 years, I can tell you that we have done so much for this issue, and the results are showing for themselves. From 2016, 2017, 2018, the number of good days, they have improved significantly. The number of bad days have in fact gone down. That's number one. We have launched the most ambitious national clean air program for the whole country, where it's not only about Delhi. We are working on improving the air quality in 102 cities which had consistently PM10 levels beyond permissible, acceptable levels. Whatever best is possible from our side. You see, although you spoke about Delhi, although we don't get the type of support that we really need from Delhi, but proactively as an environment minister from national level, although my job is only to frame policies.
Diggy 840 keh rahe hain, Sriram unka naam hai, ki aapne purn rajya par u-turn kyon kiya? Kya bhajpa abhi bhi chahti hai ki yahan purn rajya ho Delhi ke liye?
Kyunki Delhi mein aap jante hain ki purn rajya ka darja dena, yani police dena state government ko, it is not a very simple procedure. Yahan rashtrapati bhavan bhi hai, yahan par embassies bhi hain, yahan state ke government ke bhi daftar hain. अभी हमारी सरकार बनने के बाद अनफॉर्चुनेटली क्या हुआ, आपने देखा कि अभी जो दिल्ली में चीफ मिनिस्टर है, इसका आप इतने दिन में चरित्र को देख रहे हैं कि किस प्रकार का चरित्र है. वो अपने आप को एनार्किस्ट कहने में गर्व महसूस करता है, वो इंडिया गेट पे धरने करता है, वो पुलिस को रिवोल्ट करने के लिए जो है अपील करता है, वो कहता है मैं रिपब्लिक डे की परेड रोक सकता हूँ, वो चीफ सेक्रेटरी को घर में बुलाकर रात के 12 बजे अपने एमएलए से पिटवाता है. अब ऐसा चीफ मिनिस्टर हो जो कि अपने आप को अराजक कहने में गर्व महसूस करता हो, क्या आप सोचते हैं कोई भी जिम्मेदार सरकार, खाली भारत की क्या, मैं तो कहता हूँ पूरी दुनिया की भी कोई सरकार, क्या ऐसे चीफ मिनिस्टर को पुलिस अपनी पुलिस की पावर दे सकती है या देने के बारे में सोच भी सकती है?
आई डोंट थिंक. ये तो बात ये दिल्ली की ही बात नहीं है, तो किसी राज्य के बारे में भी आप कह सकते हैं. मान लीजिए आपकी आपत्ति है भी यहाँ के जो मुख्यमंत्री है जिनको लोगों ने चुना है, वो वही हालात और भी हो सकते हैं. कल उत्तर प्रदेश में कोई मुख्यमंत्री आ सकते हैं जो कुछ करना चाहें, राजस्थान में आ सकते हैं, गोवा में आ सकते हैं.
देखिए मेरा पॉइंट ये है कि दिल्ली बीइंग ए कॉम्प्लिकेटेड सिचुएशन, तो जब तक पूर्ण राज का दर्जा देने के लिए बहुत डिटेल्ड डेलिब्रेशंस विद एवरी रेलेवेंट पर्सन, एवरी वेरियस स्टेक होल्डर्स ज़रूरी हैं. ये सरकार जिस तरह का इसका बिहेवियर है, ये 4.5 साल से कोई काम कर नहीं रही सिवाय सुबह से शाम तक प्राइम मिनिस्टर को गाली देती है. आप ऐसे ऐसे ऐसी सरकार से आप कैसे इतनी बड़ी जिम्मेदारी बिना किसी डिस्कशन के, इनसे डिस्कशन ही कैसे स्टार्ट करेंगे आप, ये मुझे बताइए. अभी 4.5 साल में तो इनको पूर्ण राज का दर्जे का याद ही नहीं आया, अब अचानक इसलिए याद आया कि इनके पास कुछ बताने के लिए नहीं है कि इन्होंने दिल्ली में 4.5 साल में क्या किया.
पर आम आदमी पार्टी का कहना है कि क्योंकि राज्य एलजी और केंद्र सरकार हमें काम नहीं करने देती दे रही थी, इसलिए हम नहीं कुछ बात किए. और अब वो कह रहे हैं कि अगर पूर्ण राज्य का दर्जा दिया जाए तब बहुत सारी चीज़ें हो पाए.
देखिए मैं आपको बताना चाहता हूँ कि इस तरह के एक्सक्यूज़ वो केवल इसलिए दे रहे हैं पूर्ण राज के दर्जे से जैसे वो इशूज. अब उनका एक हमने स्टेटमेंट या ऐड देखा कि पूर्ण राज का दर्जा मिलेगा तो हम दिल्ली में कॉलेज खोलेंगे, ये करेंगे, वो करेंगे, स्कूल बनाएंगे. अब 500 स्कूल बनाने के लिए कहा, एक नहीं बनाया, 20 कॉलेज खोलने के. दिल्ली में जब मेरी सरकार थी, यानी हमारे मदन लाल खुराना जी की सरकार थी, मैं भी उसमें मंत्री था बीजेपी की, हमने दिल्ली के अंदर इतने सारे कॉलेज खोले, इंद्रप्रस्थ यूनिवर्सिटी हमने खोली, इंद्रप्रस्थ यूनिवर्सिटी में इतने सारे कॉलेज खुल गए, दिल्ली को तो पूर्ण राज का दर्जा नहीं मिला था. शीला दीक्षित जी भी 15 साल यहाँ दिल्ली में रहीं, उन्होंने भी बहुत सारे काम नए किए, उनको तो पूर्ण राज का दर्जा नहीं था. ये तो ये जो अभी चीफ मिनिस्टर महोदय हैं, इनकी मेंटालिटी ही जो है नेगेटिव मेंटालिटी है ये. और अभी कुछ काम क्योंकि कर नहीं पाए, अब उसके सारे इस तरह के एक्सक्यूज ढूंढ रहे हैं.
तो क्या अगर मैं आपकी बातों के, इफ आई कैन रीड बिटवीन द लाइंस, क्या आप कह रहे हैं कि शीला जी ने ज़्यादा अच्छा एडमिनिस्टर किया?
नहीं, अरविंद केजरीवाल तो आई थिंक ही इज़ द वर्स्ट परफॉर्मर. उन्होंने तो कुछ परफॉर्म ही नहीं किया ना.
कि शीला जी ने कुछ काम किया था?
नहीं नहीं, ऑब्वियसली देखिए, इफ इफ आई हैव टू कंपेयर बिटवीन द टू, तो शीला जी वाज सर्टेनली बेटर. एटलीस्ट हम उनको भी, हम जब वो कोई उनके सरकार में भी कोई स्कैम होता था, घोटाला होता था, आई वाज हिज स्ट्रांगेस्ट हर स्ट्रांगेस्ट क्रिटिक. लेकिन पब्लिक लाइफ में कोई डिग्निफाइड बिहेवियर होता है, कोई नॉर्म्स होते हैं, कोई इंस्टीट्यूशंस की क्रेडिबिलिटी को जिंदा रखने का जिम्मेदारी होती है, सब होता है. कोई आज तक आपने सुना 1947 से आज तक किसी चीफ मिनिस्टर ने अपने चीफ सेक्रेटरी को बुलाकर अपने एमएलए से पिटाई कराई हो उसकी?
Okay, just a couple of days still to go now for the elections in Delhi. So let's just take a look at these elections in Delhi and what will be some of the factors that the voters could keep in mind.
A triangular fight for 7 Lok Sabha seats in the national capital. After months-long parleys, the Congress in Delhi's ruling Aam Aadmi Party failed to form an alliance to take on the BJP head-on. The bickering over the seat division even played out on social media, with Congress chief Rahul Gandhi and Aam Aadmi Party convener engaging in a blame game.
Maine saaf khul ke Kejriwal ji se kaha, 7 ki 7 seaten jeetni hai, aap 4 seaton pe ladiye, hum 3 seaton pe ladenge.
So does the failure to form an alliance help the BJP? Let's first look at the results from 2014, when Modi wave swept across most of the country. The BJP won all the 7 seats, with every candidate winning by a margin of more than 100,000 votes. In second place was Aam Aadmi Party, and relegated to a humbling third was the Congress, which was the incumbent in all 7 seats. Multiple reports suggest that the Congress and the Aam Aadmi Party had come close to a 4-3 seat-sharing deal. But the Aam Aadmi Party's insistence to form alliances in Punjab and Haryana turned out to be a deal-breaker. The Aam Aadmi Party may not be entirely blamed for being adamant. Kejriwal's party got 33% of vote share in the 2014 general elections, and a year later in the assembly polls won a whopping 54.5% votes. The Congress had just got over 9% votes, but in the civic elections, party's vote share improved. A triangular contest in Delhi is clearly an advantage for the BJP. If Aam Aadmi Party and the Congress were to fight together, the vote share based on the 2014 elections is more than the BJP's in 6 of the 7 seats. 2 examples here will prove the point. In Chandni Chowk, BJP polled 44.6% of votes, while the Aam Aadmi Party Congress combined got 48.67%. Similarly, in the Northwest Delhi, the BJP received 46.45% of the votes, while the combined tally of Aam Aadmi Party and Congress was 50.18%. The numbers indicate that the BJP has a clear advantage. On May 23rd, when the ballot boxes are opened, we will get to understand Delhi's political mood in deeper details.
Okay, at the national level, few people better to tell us the way the BJP thinks the elections are going and what a candid assessment of the situation on the ground is, well, certainly from a BJP point of view, than Ram Madhav, one of the top leaders of the BJP, obviously also very closely associated with the RSS. Well, our partners at the Hindustan Times spoke to Ram Madhav, and this is what he had to say to them.
You're very confident that you're getting a majority. You don't need everyone to be, you know, on their toes or anything. You don't need the kingmakers and all of that. But so where? From where will they come? Because in Jammu and Kashmir, I read your recent statement where you said that you hope to get 3 out of 6 at least. 3 out of 6 was your last tally. You're not gaining seats there. In Northeast, you don't look like you're gaining seats because of all this, the citizen amendment bill. Then where, and you've already reached saturation in Uttar Pradesh and you have the Mahagathbandhan there. So how are you getting a majority, sir?
Look, first of all, number one, we have the king with us, so we don't need any kingmakers. Number two, if I'm retaining my seats, that means I'm already getting 282 seats. You said you are retaining only your seats, you are not getting any extra. If I retain my seats, I'm getting 282 in this country. We had 282 in the past parliament.
No, no.
And let me tell you about Northeast.
Yeah.
We BJP's strength will at least double this time. We had just 8 MPs in the outgoing parliament.
So 16
we are
out of
hoping
25.
To get not less than 14-15 seats for BJP. Plus our alliance partners together, we will get at least 20 out of 25 northeastern states.
Double? In Assam?
In Assam, we will get. We are hoping to win all the 10 seats that we have contested. Our alliance partners will win at least 2 seats out of 4. Similarly, in Nagaland, our partner is winning. In Meghalaya, Tripura. Nagaland, we have an alliance partner who will win the seat, and Tripura, Manipur and Arunachal, we will win all the seats that...
So you are saying no impact at all of the Citizen Amendment Bill and its backlash in the Northeast?
I don't think it will have any impact because we have successfully explained to the people the reality of the bill.
But you have to admit, Ram Madhavji, as optimistic as you are, that in Uttar Pradesh, you are not getting your previous
But then I am saying we are getting many seats. We are getting many seats from Eastern India, from Orissa, from Bengal. And we are going to increase our tally in some of these states in South India. Like Karnataka will give us more seats. And we are hoping to pick up more seats
but
in Telangana. We only
chunk.
Had one. We might pick up a couple more. So overall, we are not expecting any big losses. We will be able to maintain...
UP will be a loss though, sir.
We will be making
because
it up elsewhere. You see...
How do you make up for a chunk of 71 seats, sir? 72 seats?
No, are you saying we are losing 72?
No,
we will
I'm not
be losing, if at all we will lose only very few seats in the states where we have gained maximum.
Yeah.
We are trying to maintain our numbers, just as we have maintained our numbers in Jammu and Kashmir. We are increasing our tally in states like Assam. So in other states also, we are trying to maintain our numbers.
Yeah.
If at all there is any shortfall, we will make it. From other states in Eastern India, as I said.
Are you in touch with some of these fence sitters in case? Because I know that people like you who are strategists, who are forward thinking, and the difference between the BJP and the Congress is that you prepare for the worst case scenario. Are you in touch with the TRS,
look, our
with
best
the
case,
BJD and with the Jagan
Reddy? Our best case scenario is to repeat the 2014 performance. Our worst case scenario is, together with NDA, we will get 300 seats.
But are you in touch?
You see, rest of it is strategy, political strategy. And strategy is not discussed in front of cameras.
But are you in touch with them, sir? Should I take that as a...
Right now, we are confident of winning
confident,
majority.
But are you prepared for the worst case scenario?
No,
well, sir?
That's what I said. The worst case scenario is that NDA, as a coalition, will get required numbers.
But
that's the worst case scenario, I'm saying.
I know. But I'm saying that...
But anybody else is welcome to walk into NDA.
And that's our special wrap of all the election-related information that you really need to track today. We'll be back tomorrow.